This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Physical Basis of Mind. Author, George Henry Lewes. Year, 1891. Preface. The title indicates that this volume is restricted to the group of material conditions which constitute the organism in relation to the physical world, a group which furnishes the data for one half of the psychologist's quest, the other half being furnished by historical and social conditions. The human mind, so far as it is accessible to scientific inquiry, has a twofold root, man being not only an animal organism but an unit in the social organism, and hence the complete theory of its functions and faculties must be sought in this twofold direction. This conception, which has been declared to amount to a revolution in psychology, although slowly prepared by the growing conviction that man could not be isolated from humanity, was first expounded in the opening volume of These Problems of Life and Mind. At least I am not aware that any predecessor had seen how the specially human faculties of intellect and conscience were products of social factors cooperating with the animal factors. In considering the physical basis, a large place must be assigned to the mechanical and chemical relations which are involved in organic functions. Yet we have to recognize that this procedure of analysis is artificial and preparatory, that none of its results are final, none represent the synthetic reality of vital facts. Hence, one leading object of the following pages has been everywhere to substitute the biological point of view for the metaphysical and mechanical points of view which too often obstruct research, the one finding its expression in spiritualist theories, the other in materialist theories, both disregarding the plain principle that the first requisite in a theory of biological phenomena must be to view them in the light of biological conditions. In other words, to fix our gaze upon what passes in the organism, and not on what may pass in the laboratory, where the conditions are different. Analysis is a potent instrument, but is too often relied on in forgetfulness of what constitutes its real aid, and thus leads to a disregard of all those conditions which it has artificially set aside. We see this in the tendency of anatomists and physiologists to assign to one element, in a complex cluster of co-operants, the significance which properly belongs to that cluster, as when the property of a tissue is placed exclusively in a single element of that tissue, the function of an organ assigned to its chief tissue, and a function of the organism to a single organ. Another object has been to furnish the reader uninstructed in physiology with such a general outline of the structure and functions of the organism, and such details respecting the sentient mechanism, as may awaken an interest in the study and enable him to understand the application of physiology to psychology. If he comes upon details which can only interest specially educated students, or perhaps only by them be really understood, he can pass over these details, for their omission will not seriously affect the bearing of the general principles. I have given the best I had to give, and must leave each reader to find in it whatever may interest him. The uses of books are first to stimulate inquiry by awakening an interest. Secondly, to clarify and classify the knowledge already gained from direct contemplation of the phenomena. They are stimuli and aids to observation and thought. They should never be allowed to see for us, nor to think for us. The volume contains four essays. The first, On the Nature of Life, deals with the speciality of organic phenomena as distinguished from the inorganic. It sets forth the physiological principles which psychology must incessantly invoke. In the course of the exposition, I have incorporated several passages from four articles on Mr. Darwin's hypotheses, contributed to the fortnightly review during the year 1868. I have also suggested a modification of the hypothesis of natural selection by extending to the tissues and organs that principle of competition which Mr. Darwin has so luminously applied to organisms. Should this generalization of the struggle for existence be accepted, it will answer many of the hitherto unanswerable objections. The second essay is on the nervous mechanism, setting forth what is known and what is inferred, respecting the structure and properties of that all-important system. If the skeptical and revolutionary attitude, in presence of opinions currently held to be established truths, surprises or pains the reader unprepared for such doubts, I can only ask him to submit my statements to a similar skepticism and confront them with the ascertained evidence. After many years of laborious investigation and meditation, the conclusion has slowly forced itself upon me that on this subject there is a false persuasion of knowledge, very fatal in its influence, because unhesitatingly adopted as the ground of speculation both in pathology and psychology. This persuasion is sustained because few are aware how much of what passes for observation is in reality sheer hypothesis. I have had to point out the great extent to which imaginary anatomy has been unsuspectingly accepted, and hope to have done something towards raising a rational misgiving in the student's mind respecting the superstition of the nerve cell, a superstition which I freely confess to have shared in for many years. The third essay treats of animal automatism. Here, the constant insistence on the biological point of view, while it causes a rejection of the mechanical theory, admits the fullest recognition of all the mechanical relations involved in animal movements, and thus endeavors to reconcile the contending schools. In this essay, I have also attempted a psychological solution of that much debated question, the relation between body and mind. This solution explains why physical and mental phenomena must necessarily present to our apprehension such profoundly diverse characters, and shows that materialism, in attempting to deduce the mental from the physical, puts into the conclusion what the very terms have excluded from the premises, whereas on the hypothesis of a physical process being only the objective aspect of a mental process, the attempt to interpret the one by the other is as legitimate as the solution of a geometrical problem by algebra. In the final essay, the reflex theory is discussed. And here, once more, the biological point of view rectifies the error of an analysis which has led to the denial of sensibility in reflex actions, because that analysis has overlooked the necessary presence of the conditions which determine sensibility. In these chapters are reproduced several passages from the Physiology of Common Life. According to my original intention, this volume was to have included an exposition of the part one conceived the brain to play in physiological and psychological processes, but that must be postponed until it can be accompanied by a survey of psychological processes which would render the exposition more intelligible. The Priory, March 1877. Problem 1. The Nature of Life. La physiologie est pour, but d'exposer les phenomenes de la vie humaine et les conditions do ils dependent. Pour y arriver d'une manière sure, il faut nécessairement avant tout déterminer quels sont les phenomenes qu'on design sous le nom de vie en général. C'est pourquoi la première chose à faire est d'étudier les propriétés générales du corps qu'on appelle organiques ou vivants. Tiedemann, Traité de physiologie de l'homme I2. Some weak and inexperienced persons vainly seek by dialectics and far-fetched arguments either to upset or establish things that are only to be founded on anatomical demonstration and believed on the evidence of the senses. He who truly desires to be informed of the question in hand must be held bound either to look for himself or to take on trust the conclusions to which they who have looked have come. Harvey, Second Dissertation to Riolin. Topic: The Nature of Life. Chapter 1. The Problem Stated. 1. Although for convenience we use the terms life and mind as representing distinct orders of phenomena, the one objective and the other subjective, and although for centuries they have designated distinct entities or forces having different substrata, we may now consider it sufficiently acknowledged among scientific thinkers that every problem of mind is necessarily a problem of life, referring to one special group of vital activities. It is enough that mind is never manifested, except in a living organism, to make us seek in an analysis of organic phenomena for the material conditions of every mental fact. Mental phenomena, when observed in others, although interpretable by our consciousness of what is passing in ourselves, can only be objective phenomena of the vital organism. 2. On this ground, if on this alone, an acquaintance with the general principles of structure and function is indispensable to the psychologist. Although only of late years has this been fully recognized, so that men profoundly ignorant of the organism have had no hesitation in theorizing on its highest functions. In saying that such knowledge is indispensable, I do not mean that in the absence of such knowledge, a man is debarred from understanding much of the results reached by investigators, nor that he may not himself make useful observations and classifications of psychological facts. It is possible to read books on natural history with intelligence and profit, and even to make good observations without a scientific groundwork of biological instruction. And it is possible to arrive at empirical facts of hygiene and medical treatment without any physiological instruction. But in all three cases, the absence of a scientific basis will render the knowledge fragmentary and incomplete, and this ought to deter everyone from offering an opinion on debatable questions which pass beyond the limit of subjective observations. The psychologist who has not prepared himself by a study of the organism has no more right to be heard on the genesis of the psychical states or of the relations between body and mind than one of the laity has a right to be heard on a question of medical treatment. Topic: The position of biology. 3. Science is the systematic classification of experience. It postulates unity of existence with great varieties in the modes of existence, assuming that there is one matter everywhere the same, under great diversities in the complications of its elements. The distinction of modes is not less indispensable than the identification of the elements. These modes range themselves under three supreme heads: force, life, mind. Under the first, range the general properties exhibited by all substances. Under the second, the general properties exhibited by organized substances. Under the third, the general properties exhibited by organized animal substances. The first class is subdivided into physics, celestial and terrestrial, and chemistry. Physics treats of substances which move as masses or which vibrate and rotate as molecules, without undergoing any appreciable change of structural integrity. They show changes of position and state, without corresponding changes in their elements. Chemistry treats of substances which undergo molecular changes of composition, destructive of their integrity. Thus, the blow which simply moves one body or makes it vibrate explodes another. The friction which alters the temperature and electrical state of a bit of glass ignites a bit of phosphorus, and so destroys its integrity of structure, converting phosphorus into phosphoric acid. 4. The second class, while exhibiting both physical and chemical properties, is markedly distinguished by the addition of properties called vital. Their peculiarity consists in this: they undergo molecular changes of composition and decomposition, which are simultaneous, and by this simultaneity preserve their integrity of structure. They change their state and their elements, yet preserve their unity, and even when differentiating, continue specific. Unlike all other bodies, the organized are born, grow, develop, and decay through a prescribed series of graduated evolutions, each stage being the indispensable condition of its successor, no stage ever appearing except in its serial order. 5. The third class, while exhibiting all the characteristics of the two preceding classes, is specialized by the addition of a totally new property called sensibility, which subjectively is feeling. Here, organized substance has become animal substance, and vegetality has been developed into animality by the addition of new factors, new complexities of the elementary forces. Many, if not most, philosophers postulate an entirely new existence, and not simply a new mode, to account for the manifestations of mind. They refuse to acknowledge it to be a vital manifestation. They demand that to life be added a separate substratum, the soul. This is not a point to be discussed here. We may be content with the assertion that however great the phenomenal difference between humanity and animality, a difference we shall hereafter see to be the expression of a new factor, namely the social factor, nevertheless the distinctive attribute of sensibility, out of which rise emotion and cognition, marks the inseparable kinship of mental with vital phenomena. Thus all the various modes of existence may, at least in their objective aspect, be ranged under the two divisions of inorganic and organic, non-living and living, and these are respectively the objects of the cosmological and the biological sciences. 6. The various sciences, in their serial development, develop the whole art of method. Mathematics develops abstraction, deduction, and definition. Astronomy, abstraction, deduction, and observation. Physics adds experiment. Chemistry adds nomenclature. Biology adds classification. And for the first time brings into prominence the important notion of conditions of existence and the variation of phenomena under varying conditions, so that the relation of the organism to its medium is one never to be left out of sight. In biology also clearly emerges for the first time what I regard as the true notion of causality, namely the procession of causes, the combination of factors in the product, and not an ab extra determination of the product. In vitality and sensibility, we are made aware that the causes are in and not outside the organism, that the organic effect is the organic cause in operation, that there is autonomy but no autocracy. The effect issues as a resultant of the cooperating conditions. In sociology, finally, we see brought into prominence the historical conditions of existence. From the due appreciation of the conditions of existence, material and historical, we seize the true significance of the principle of relativity. 7. Having thus indicated the series of the abstract sciences, we have now to consider more closely the character of biology. The term was proposed independently, yet simultaneously in Germany and France, in the year 1802, by Treviranus and Lamarck, to express the study of the forms and phenomena of life, the conditions and laws by which these exist, and the causes which produce them. Yet only of late years has it gained general acceptance in France and England. The term cosmology, for what are usually called the physical sciences, has not yet come into general use, although its appropriateness must eventually secure its recognition. Biology, the abstract science of life embracing the whole organic world, includes vegetality, animality, and humanity. The biological sciences are phytology, zoology, and anthropology. Each of the sciences has its cardinal divisions, statical and dynamical, namely morphology, the science of form, and physiology, the science of function. Morphology embraces, 1 degree, anatomy, i.e., the description of the parts then and there present in the organism, and these parts or organs are further described by the enumeration of their constituent tissues and elements, and of these again, the proximate principles, so far as they can be isolated without chemical decomposition. 2 degrees, organogeny, i.e., the history of the evolution of organs and tissues. Physiology embraces the properties and functions of the tissues and organs, the primary conditions of growth and development, out of which rise the higher functions, bringing the organism into active relation with the surrounding medium. The first group of properties and functions are called those of vegetal or organic life, the second those of animal or relative life. Topic: organisms. 8. It will be needful to fix with precision the terms organism, life, property, and function. An organism, although usually signifying a more or less complex unity of organs, because the structures which first attracted scientific attention were all thus markedly distinguished from inorganic bodies, has by the gradual extensions of research been necessarily generalized, till it now stands for any organized substance capable of independent vitality, in other words, any substance having the specific combination of elements which manifests the serial phenomena of growth, development, and decay. There are organisms that have no differentiated organs. Thus, a microscopic formless lump of semi-fluid jelly-like substance, protoplasm, is called an organism because it feeds itself and reproduces itself. There are advantages and disadvantages in such extensions of terms. These are notable in the parallel extension of the term life, which originally expressing only the complex activities of complex organisms, has come to express the simplest activities of protoplasm. Thus, a monad is an organism, a cell is an organism, a plant is an organism, a man is an organism. And each of these organisms is said to have its life, because there is one fundamental group of conditions, one organized substance, one vitality. Obviously, this unity is an abstraction. In reality, the life manifested in the man is not the life manifested in the monad. He has functions and faculties which the monad has no trace of. And if the two organisms have certain vital characteristics in common, this unity is only recognized in an ideal construction which lets drop all concrete differences. The life is different when the organism is different. Hence, any definition of life would be manifestly insufficient, which while it expressed the activities of the monad, left unexpressed the conspicuous and important activities of higher organisms. A sundial and a repeater will each record the successive positions of the sun and the heavens. But although both are instruments for marking time, the sundial will not do the work of the repeater. The complexity and delicacy of the watch mechanism are necessary for its more varied and delicate uses. A semi-fluid bit of protoplasm will feed itself, but it will not feed and sustain a complex animal, nor will it feel and think. 9. Neglect of this point has caused frequent confusion in the attempts to give satisfactory definitions. Biologists ought to have been warned by the fact that some of the most widely accepted definitions exclude the most conspicuous phenomena of life, and are only applicable to the vegetable world or to the vegetal processes in the animal world. A definition, however abstract, should not exclude essential characters. The general consent of mankind has made life synonymous with mode of existence. By the life of an animal is meant the existence of that animal. When dead, the animal no longer exists. The substances of which the organism was composed exist, but under another mode. Their connexus is altered and the organism vanishes in the alteration. It is a serious mistake to call the corpse an organism, for that special combination which constituted the organism is not present in the corpse. This misconception misleads some speculative minds into assigning life to the universe. The universe assuredly exists, but it does not live. Its existence can only be identified with life, such as we observe in organisms, by a complete obliteration of the speciality which the term life is meant to designate. Yet many have not only pleased themselves with such a conception, but have conceived the universe to be an organism fashioned, directed, and sustained by a soul like that of man, the anima mundi. This is to violate all scientific canons. The life of a plant organism is not the same as the life of an animal organism. The life of an animal organism is not the same as the life of a human organism. Nor can the life of a human organism be the same as the life of the world organism. The unity of existences does not obliterate the variety of modes, yet it is the speciality of each mode which science investigates. To some of these modes, the term life is consistently applied, to others not. And if we merge them all in a common term, we must then invent a new term to designate the modes now included under life. 10. In resisting this unwarrantable extension of the term, I am not only pointing to a speculative error, but also to a serious biological error common in both spiritualist and materialist schools, namely that of assigning life to other than organic agencies. Instead of recognizing the speciality of this mode of existence as dependent on a speciality of the organic conditions, the spiritualist assigns life to some extra-organic vital principle. The materialist assigns it to some inorganic agent, physical or chemical. Waiving for the present all discussion of vitalism, let us consider in what sense we must separate organic from all inorganic phenomena. 11. There is a distinction between inorganic and organic which may fitly be called radical. It lies at the root of the phenomena and must be accepted as an ultimate fact, although the synthesis on which it depends is analytically reducible to a complication of more primitive conditions. It has been already indicated in Section 1. All organisms above the very simplest are syntheses of three terms: structure, aliment, and instrument. Crystals, like all other anorganisms, have structure, and in a certain sense they may be said to grow, minerally accrescunt, though the growth is by increase and not by modification. The motherly, which is the food of the crystal, is never brought to the crystal nor prepared for it by any instrumental agency of the crystal. Organisms are exclusively instrumental. The organ is an instrument. The structural integrity of an organism is thus preserved through an alimentation which is effected through special instruments. Nothing like this is visible in anorganisms. The increase of a crystal is further distinguishable from the growth of an organism in the fact of its being simple accretion without development, and the structure of the crystal is distinguishable from that of an organism in the fact that its integrity is preserved by the exclusion of all molecular change, and not by the simultaneous changes of molecular decomposition and recomposition. Inorganic substances are sometimes as unstable as organic, sometimes even more unstable, but their instability is the source of their structural destruction. They change into other species, whereas the instability of organized substances, not of organic, is the source of their structural integrity. The tissue is renovated, and its renovation is a consequence of its waste. 12. But while the distinction is thus radical, when we view the organism from the real, that is, from the synthetic point of view, we must also urge the validity of the analytical point of view, which seizes on the conditions here complicated in a special group, and declares these conditions to be severally recognizable equally in anorganisms and in organisms. All the fundamental properties of matter are recognizable in organized matter. The elementary substances and forces familiar to physicists and chemists are the materials of the biologist. Nor has there been found a single organic substance, however special, that is not reducible to inorganic elements. We see then that organized matter is only a special combination of that which in other combinations presents chemical and physical phenomena, and we are prepared to find chemistry and physics indispensable aids in our analysis of organic phenomena. Aids but only aids, indispensable but insufficient. 13. There is therefore an ambiguity in the common statement that organized matter is not ordinary matter. Indisputable in one sense, this is eminently disputable when it is interpreted as evidence of a peculiar vital force, wholly unallied with the primary energy of motion. If by ordinary matter be meant earths, crystals, gases, vapors, then assuredly organized matter is not ordinary. Between the living state of matter and its non-living state, says Dr. Beale, there is an absolute and irreconcilable difference. So far from our being able to demonstrate that the non-living passes by gradations into or gradually assumes the scale or condition of the living, the transition is sudden and abrupt, and matter already in the living state may pass into the non-living condition in the same sudden and complete manner. The ambiguity here is sensible in the parallel case of the difference between crystallizable and coagulable matter, or between one crystal and another. If we can decompose the organic into the inorganic, This shows that the elements of the one are elements of the other. And if we are not yet able to recompose the inorganic elements into organic matter, not at least in its more complex forms, may this not be due to the fact that we are ignorant of the proximate synthesis, ignorant of the precise way in which the elements are combined? I may have every individual.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.